delighted to be here with you this morning. God is so good. He's already been ministering to my heart for me to come back and do this kind of thing. It's a little different. You know, I only did it for 55 years, but you know, coming back, realizing what it is to pray a message through, what it is to touch God's heart, let Him touch my heart. Very important. I see many of you folk that we've shared with this way and that way over the years, and it's a delight. But the first thing I feel like I'd like us to do this morning, I'd feel at home if you just would join me in lifting your hands and saying to the Lord this morning, anything you want to say to Him. Just tell Him you love Him. Express yourselves to Him. Write out loud. It's all right. It's all right. Just express yourself to Him this morning. Take a few moments here and just to say, Lord, I love You. We love You. My family loves You. Father, we're here in Your house. We're in Your presence. We've come to receive of You. We've come to be empowered by You. We've come to let, Lord, You have Your way. Have Your way in through the ministering of the Word this morning. But Lord, have Your way in our hearts, in our house, in our expression of You. Oh, thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord. Glory to God. Glory, 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 glory to God. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Wonderful Lord. Wonderful Lord. Oh, glory. Glory, glory, glory. Magnificent Lord. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Praising the Lord is as good as a shower. That's quite vernacular, isn't it? It just seems to be something refreshing about honoring the Lord. And I appreciate the team in the middle of the summer group that's gathered together here. Those who have helped us this morning, first and second services. And you know, I think about the Rangers. I think they're on their way home. When did they get home? Tonight. Tonight. With all their chigger bites and everything else, coming home from southern Missouri. By the way, southern Missouri isn't that bad. That's where I met Anita, my wife. And that's where we were married. In fact, the Rangers, they will have traveled through the outskirts of the community. Well, actually, on the highway, they will have passed my wife's house by a block and a half where she lived and the school we attended. So, interesting. Interesting. And talk about Missouri. Could we bring up the first slide today? That is in southern Missouri. That is your pastor and wife yesterday in their home near Evangel College when Anita and I went to visit them. And we had lunch with them that day. And by the way, that dress that Shirley Jean has on, she made. He was always very much into it. Isn't he a tall, lanky Missourian? Yes. His dimensions are a little bit different, though, I realize now. And while we're sharing and just talking this morning, I consider it an honor to be here and to be filling the pulpit, not the shoes of Pastor Moore. I respect him very, very highly. He is a good pastor and he is a good presbyter. And he serves the southern section, which is the best section in the state. And we consider it a privilege to have him be leading the ministers and their wives and their churches here in the southern section. Today I want to talk to you about being in the house. How many stayed last night in a tent? Just ask. Why I ask that is, whether it was a tent or a cottage, the old song used to say, why should I care? They're building a mansion for me over there. But when Jesus was upon this earth, very interesting, he was invited into some houses, and some houses he wasn't invited in. But the house that I'm looking at today, he was invited in, but the doors were wide open and his critics came into the house with him. Must have been a pretty good sized house because he had a lot of critics, so for them to get in, you know, there was place for them there. But I'd like you to turn with me. Well, we'll put it on the screen if you have trouble turning in your Bibles, but it's Mark the second chapter, verses 1 through 12 that we're looking at today. And while you're looking at that passage, can we bring number 2 up? There we are. When you're looking at that passage, I want to say hello to my daughter. I don't know which camera she's on, but my daughter Esther and her new husband Ron are listening to this service all the way from Ecuador today. And how do I know that? When I arrived here, somebody brought me a message and said, it just came on my something, and Esther wanted us to say to you that she would be listening to the service and watching the service this morning. So you folks are reaching around the world, aren't you? Yes, and that's exciting. Would you read the scriptures with me today? Would you stand as you read them together in respect to God's word? And again he entered Capernaum after some days. Read with me. And it was heard that he was in the house. Immediately many gathered together so that there was no longer room to receive them, not even near the door. And he preached the word to them. Then they came to him, bringing a paralytic that was carried by 4 men. And when they would not come near him because of the crowd, they uncovered the roof where he was. So when they had broken through, they let down the bed on which the paralytic was lying. And when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, son, your sins are forgiven you. And some of the scribes were sitting there unreasoning in their hearts. What does this man speak? Blasphemies like this? Who can forgive sins but God alone? But immediately when Jesus perceived in his spirit that they reasoned thus within themselves, he said to them, why do you reason about these things in your hearts. Which is easier, to say to the paralytic, your sins are forgiven you, or to say, arise, take up your bed, and walk? But that you might know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralytic, I say to you, arise, take up your bed, and go to your house. And immediately he arose, took up the bed, and went out in the presence of them all, so that all were amazed and glorified God, saying, we never saw anything like this. Heavenly Father, we ask your blessing upon the reading of the word. We ask that this morning that, Lord, you may not only talk to our hearts and speak to our minds and direct our lives, but within this hour, may we sense your divine spirit just flowing through our entire being as our relationship with you is strengthened and is blessed. God, minister to each and every one, including myself, within this time. And everyone said, amen. You may be seated. Jesus does not always get into the house. I've come to some churches at times when the door was locked, and I've said, well, even Jesus has problems getting in here. But then I realized that the Lord didn't worry about locks and everything after the time of his resurrection. He just seemed to move where he needed to go by his spirit. And he does that with our hearts. And your heart today may be fighting God. It may be having a difficult time. But if it is, remember, God still loves you. And Jesus wants to minister to you even this very morning. Sometimes, even the doors are shut in his face. Anyone here was ever a door-to-door salesman? Interesting. How many of you have ever just gone around the block, knocking on doors for Jesus' sake, ministering or ready to witness to somebody? Uh-huh. Were all the doors always open to you? No. Did you try to apply the old salesman trick of slipping your foot in the door before they could get it closed? Well, when I look at the book of Revelation and the third chapter, it says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and, this translation says, and dine with him, and he with me. Sometimes Jesus even comes in uninvited. Why do I say that? Many of the experiences that I've had in life have been with people who were in such turmoil, such shock, such heavy difficulty, that really they didn't know what they were doing. I've had some that after I got in there wanted to throw me out. But nevertheless, that wasn't the question. They needed what I had within me. They needed Jesus. And when we think of Christ, he always accepts an invitation to come in. In fact, the scripture said, if a man open the door, I will come in. You know, as the air rushes in to fill the empty space, so does the grace of God press in at every opportunity and opening that comes in our hearts. I love the scripture that says, open your mouth and I will fill it. I think of it being a big empty space at times, and a lot of what people have to say shows that there's a big empty space there. But Christ comes and he will fill it with his love, with his compassion, with caring. He'll just fill our lives abundantly to overflowing. Now, in the passage that we're reading this morning, I like the idea that Jesus condescended to come into that house. Now, Isaiah, the 57th chapter in the 15th verse says, he that inhabiteth eternity dwelleth with him that is of a contrite and humble spirit. Now, the Almighty God seeks entrance into our hearts that we might have a time of, well, some of the Old Testament words, that we may sup with him. More modern one would be dine with him. And we would say that I may have coffee with him, that I may fellowship with him. Yes, he wants to have. He began that in the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve. In the cool of the day, he just loved to come within their house, which was the Garden of Eden, and just sit down and share with them and talk with them and be with them. And so we think of the Christ today that would come, the one that was laid in a manger. You know, the humble circumstances of the manger remind me that it doesn't matter what your house is as far as the appointments are concerned. God still is willing to come and sit with you. We had a newspaper reporter coming to visit us one day in our first church. We didn't have too much furniture, didn't have too much of anything. And that was the house that, as we lived in it, every night when we'd been married, we had 400 candles that were used in our wedding. And what are you going to do with 400 candles after the wedding? Well, every night there wasn't a lot of appointments in the house, and Anita would put a candle on the little table that was just big enough for two of us. We'd sit there by the window with a candle burning and eat our supper. And you didn't see how empty the house was, but the house was filled with love. But we had a neighbor out back. And every night the neighbors, you know, they small town, they knew everything was happening. They thought they did. And they would come by the window. They'd take a quick look and go on. One time it was one child, even the adults. And finally, one day they asked me, said, what kind of religious services are you holding there each night? I thought they understood what it was to be rheumatic, but in that same house, we had this couch that was partly broken, and the spring would come out. And I remember before the reporter came, we had one chair that we knew would hold the lady without problems, and Anita and I practiced. She stood here, I stood here, we practiced welcoming her in. She moved just the right time. I moved just the right time. So that we ushered her into the one chair that the spring would pop out underneath and hitch in the leg or something else like that. You remember how some of the old furniture was. But, you know, Jesus is willing to come into any house. And he started by doing it, by coming to to a manger. And when he comes in, he fills the house. In fact, verse 2 of our passage that we read said there's no room. There was no room. You know, in this house, there was no need for worldly entertainment to attract when Jesus came in, and there isn't when he's there. When he comes in, he also brings a company of people with him, of friends, and that was what would happen there. There were just a lot of folks. And when Jesus comes in, I love to think about the passage we were dealing Wednesday night in the men's ministry here about, it said, when they had prayed that the glory of the Lord came down and filled the temple. And when I think of how that the glory comes, it fills the house. Is your house filled with the glory of the Lord? Think about it. You see, Jesus is the fullness of the Godhead, and he can fill up every desire and longing of our hearts and can be filled, yes, with the fullness of God. When Jesus comes in, I think of Luke chapter 24, verse 36, it says, "Now as they said these things, Jesus himself stood in the midst of them and said, peace to you." He does bring peace to us, doesn't he? I like the passage in Isaiah 57, verse 15. It says, "For thus says the high and lofty one who inhabits eternity, whose name is holy, I dwell in the high and holy place with him who has a contrite and humble spirit, to revive the spirit of the humble and to revive the heart of the contrite ones." That's our Christ. Whatever your need is, he comes to meet it and just to take your hand, hold your hand for a while, talk to you, put his arm around you, tell you he loves you. Christ comes and he fills the heart, our hearts, our love, our home, whatever it might be. Now, when Jesus is in the house, his presence is not hid. We cannot separate influence from the presence of Christ any more than we can have the rose without its fragrance. Or we have gold without color. Or have sun without light. You see, if Jesus Christ dwells in our hearts, the love of Christ begins to flow and flow about. And we know, and everyone knows, that Jesus is there. There's an old song we used to sing. We didn't sing it this morning. We sang several others, and I knew all the words to them. We used to sing, "Since Jesus came into my heart." And our whole being begins to change when he comes in. You see, when Jesus comes in, he leaves the door open for others to follow. He doesn't shut people out. And you know what? His words are even heard without, you know, on the outside. Because the door is open. I think about when a person gets saved, they're just bubbling over so much. And in their bubbling over experience, everybody knows about Jesus because Jesus bubbles all over out of their being, and everybody gets blessed. Now, I need to tell you, though, that when you come to Jesus, sometimes it's with difficulty. And you may meet difficulties in coming to him. In this case, there was a crowd of hearers around the door. And did you know that sometimes hearers stand in the way of seekers? Uh-oh. Sometimes we get so stiff and starchy in our religious, I didn't call it Christian experience, I said our religious experience, that we're not ready to move an inch out of our rut to let a sinner get to Jesus Christ. In the early service, I told them about a lady one time who always had her seat. It was the third seat on the aisle from the front in what was the old Gospel Lighthouse. And when she would come to church, that was her seat. There was no question about it. And one day I had some friends come, and my young child was their guest, and they walked down the aisle. And where did they sit? They sat in that third seat. And pretty soon, the owner of that seat walked in and down the aisle, and they got down there. They could count. They couldn't believe it. Someone was sitting in their seat. And they went all the way, and they plumped down in the backsliders row. Well, being a young pastor, I didn't want to have problems in my church. I saw what had happened. I'd been up front at the time, and so I made my way down. Not immediately, you know, I didn't go straight there, but I worked it out, and I went down and got my family to move to another seat. And, you know, my child and the friends. And then I used the best diplomacy that I could. Instead of my going to the individual to say, your seat is now open, I got one of the older folk at the church. I said, would you please tell this dear sister that her seat is available? And sure enough, she came down and took up residency, and she was there. Now, use that illustration today, because sometimes in the house of the Lord, it's hard for people to get to Jesus because of all of our... I went to a church one time in Kansas City, Missouri. My friend pastored the church. He'd worked for me, and I was walking in by surprise, and I hadn't seen him yet. But when I walked in, do you know that everyone in that foyer was so much in their cliques that we had a hard job getting in not only to the foyer, but into the sanctuary. And we finally got in the sanctuary, and not one person put their hand out for us, or not one person kind of helped show us the way or anything else. But I said that this morning because in Jesus' time, here was an example of people having a hard time getting to Jesus. And many people won't enter themselves. They won't push people aside, but they'd love to get to Jesus. And so we have to not be afraid of using new methods to get to Jesus. If we're bringing folk to him, in this case, what'd they do? I could see Pastor Moore now going up and helping pull the roof pieces upside so they could lower this man down to where Jesus would be. He needed healing. He needed help. He needed to get to Jesus. There was only one person who could help. That was Christ. The roads, the doors were blocked. There were so many people in there, kept away, you know, by one translation says by the press. And, you know, sometimes that is true. But they were determined to get him to Jesus. And I was going to say, if you can't get people into Jesus, do what they did here. Let them down through the roof. And if you can't get them out, get them through at the gate, then there was one time they let them over the wall in a basket. Think about that one. And let me take you a step further. The people coming to Jesus that really need to get to Jesus, if they don't know some of our vernacular that we use in church, like the word bully, say to them, come. Find ways of talking, their language, what they understand. Let them feel your heart beat for them. And as you do, it may be, you know, when you come in, it may not, you're setting your regular seat, you may set someplace where they're comfortable, but bring them to Jesus. They want really Jesus if they know how to get to him. And so today, you know, out of it, you may be called a roof-breaking fanatic. There may be other names that you're called, but remember, sin-sick souls need Jesus. And this might be the new fashion, but it might be worth it. I ask in the early service, and I oftentimes do, in First Assembly, we were having complications, you know. We were wanting to reach more people than we were doing. And finally, one day, among other things we did, you know, you did everything you could think of. And they came along with Heaven's Gates and Hell's Flames. There was no preaching, but there was an altar call. And literally, we saw on several occasions, a number of occasions, more than 1,000 people jam into that auditorium and so forth, as high as 1,100. But what were the results? There wasn't any preaching. There was a little play. A little thing happened, and an altar call was given. And when the altar call was given, we saw sometimes over 100 people in one service walk down to that altar, and then they would be led back into with counselors and so forth. Time to talk with Jesus. And when I asked this morning, maybe there's someone, is there anyone here ever came to hear Heaven's Gates, Hell's Flame? Oh, yes. And in those services, there were people that were saved, found Jesus Christ in that time. But it was another way of raising the roof, another way of getting to Jesus, but another way of doing things. And this week you've got Vacation Bible School. That's another way. And I saw the children as they slipped out for Children's Church this morning. It's an important way that they find Jesus. I want to tell you, many people never come to Jesus unless they're brought. That sick man, he could have never come to Jesus except that he was carried. And he certainly would have never been healed had he not been brought to Jesus. Did you know it takes 4 to bring a sinner to Jesus? That's what there was on that day, wasn't there? There were 4 men that brought the sick man to Jesus. Well, I think there's the law of God. There's the Spirit of God. There's the Word of God. There's the servant of God. And we all become coupled together in bringing to Jesus. Unless the Holy Spirit works within us, we do not have the strength, we do not have the anointing, we do not have the words, we do not have the ability to help a person to come to Jesus. In all my years of ministry, I've never saved one yet. But as I brought him to Jesus, He forgave them of their sins. He came into the heart. He washed them and made them pure and clean within. And His Spirit abiding within just changed their lives. You know, when a man is really anxious to be saved, he'll not be ashamed to be helped. When a person is sick and they really want to get help, I'll tell you what, they go to this one and that one and the other one and five other people, but when we're told we can come to Jesus, He's the one. He's the one who can help us. And I think about today, you talk to a person about Christ, they'll blush, they'll fidget when they're talked to about their need of salvation, the presence of offering. Sometimes it almost feels like offering to run for a doctor for a man who believes himself in good help. That's the way they may react. But when I think of the man of Ethiopia, he was glad of direction because his soul was in deep concern. Think about the jailer. He was ready. He was in trouble. The jail had been broken open. He needed help. And it was God who ministered to him by coming into his heart. In fact, he even followed the Lord in waters baptism. Now, I want to tell you that when a man is healed, his life will show it. No man can ever remain the same after coming into contact with Jesus Christ. My daddy, who preached for many, many years, always said, once in a Pentecostal church, never the same. Think about that. Once in a Pentecostal church, never the same. And of course, he believed in old-fashioned Holy Ghost services, people finding Christ and things happening and all. But our lives will show it. Do you know that the sun either softens or it hardens? It revives or it withers. This man that day, the very bed on his back that he walked out with, Jesus said, take up your bed and walk. And he took his bed. That was the very evidence that a great change had happened within his life. And all people whose sins are forgiven are called upon to glorify God in their body. I want to tell you today that Jesus is sufficient for all who will come to Him. He was all sufficient for the sick, for the palsied. He was all sufficient for faith of those who were brought to Him. He was all sufficient to read the hearts of the reasoning onlookers who were asking questions. And 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8 says, God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that ye, having always all sufficiency in all things, may abound in every good work. I love what John 6:37 says. It says, Him that cometh to me, I will not in no wise cast out. I ask the question today, is Jesus in your house? I brought along with me a little story. In the late 1800s, a 19-year-old boy stumbled into a holiness camp meeting in Greenville, Texas. He was barefoot. He was ignorant. He was the child of a local bootlegger. His name was Buddy Robinson. He had such a bad speech impediment that he couldn't even be understood. He'd never been in a gospel in his entire life. He'd been known a life of being beaten, abused, neglected. He was 19 years of age. He'd never had a pair of shoes because his drunken, half-witted, bootleggered father made his life a living hell. He sat on the back row of the holiness camp meeting. That night, God touched his life. And Buddy Robinson stumbled down the sawdust aisle. He fell at the altar and he gave his life to Jesus Christ. He went to a local church after that and he asked, can you imagine, for a license to preach? Some of us are going to say, you got to wait 50 years before that happens. And they laughed at him. Partly because he couldn't be understood. He had a stammer that was so bad that he couldn't even put two words together. And they laughed at him. He came back the next year and applied again. Then he came back the next year and applied again. And on the fourth year, he came back. And he appealed directly to the district superintendent. And the superintendent said, well, just give him a license. What can it hurt? Just give him a license. And he said, now, buddy, here's your license. Show up the same time next year at this meeting and give us a report of your ministry. But he came back the next year. He sat in the back row of the quarterly conference. Superintendent said to all the people present, well, let's hear the report of your ministry. He never called on Buddy Robinson. And finally, Buddy raised his hand and he said, district superintendent, you never called on me. The superintendent replied, well, buddy, I forgot about you. Come on up here and give us a report of your ministry. With about this year, I worked 10 hours a day and got somebody to teach me how to read, and I've memorized the book of John. I bought me a mule, and I preached in 19 towns. I've won 375 people to Jesus. He said, but if you'll be patient with me, I'll do better next year. Buddy Robinson became one of the greatest evangelists in the early part of this century. Tens and thousands of people sat under brush arbors, as they used in the South, tabernacles, auditoriums, to hear a silly old man with a speech impediment declare the wondrous riches of a gracious Savior. Buddy Robinson became one of the most anointed men of that generation. He became known as Uncle Buddy. Kindly known. He was a man of an anointing, of simplicity, purity of heart, holiness of life, rich love, a profound understanding of his age, and the ability somehow or another, despite all the human failings, to communicate the whole gospel to all men. I'm reminded this morning of a 17-year-old boy who walked into a church on Port Watson Street in Cortland, New York. A boy whose father had died when he was 6, who made his own living from the age of 9. One who was working on the high roads, running a big roller, big equipment, strong but skinny, 6-foot-plus young man. Young lady invited him to come with her, and he went. And he knelt at the altar and asked Jesus Christ into his heart. He didn't know much about the gospel, but he soon began to learn. The church had a street meeting on Saturday when it came up, and the preacher asked him, he said, "Would you carry the portable organ down to the street meeting?" That's what they used in those days. And, you know, he was all brawn, and the young girl was going to the street meeting too. And he got down to the street meeting, set up the organ, got it all fixed up, and then he moved back over next to the bank, away from the street meeting, where all of his buddies were lined up. And service was going on, and the preacher, he called out and he said, "Nelson, would you like to say something of what God has done for you?" And for the first time, my father gave his first testimony. He walked from that crowd over by the bank, out of the group, and told how that Jesus Christ is coming, had come into his heart. There was room in the house for him, and he made room for Christ over his life. In his ministry of over 50 years, he either helped develop or worked with 35 different churches, starting many of them from nothing and then turning them over to someone else. Later on, suffering a heavy heart attack and in the recovery, he got involved with Royal Rangers. And he was at the Camporama down at North Carolina, wherever it was down there. Pigeon, something like that down there. Anyway, in his last 5 weeks of his life, he led some 140 some men and boys to the Lord Jesus Christ, and 40 some he prayed with to receive, were infilled with the baptism of the Holy Spirit. You see, when we make room for Jesus, and we bring people into the house where Jesus is, he doesn't turn a single one aside. He's not too busy for any person. He wants to help all to know of the presence and the love of his Father and to have the hope of heaven. You know, there may be someone here today whose heart has been crowded out people on the outside may think that you're just everything's all right. But in these moments, you will say, I'm in trouble. I need Jesus. And he let me come into his house today to talk to him. And I would like to ask Jesus to come into my heart, to move my troubles aside, to forgive me of my mistakes, and to share his wonderful love that I may have the warmth and the goodness and the presence of Jesus abiding within. And Pastor, this morning, someone may say, I started out for Christ, but somehow I've been outside the house. I've been outside. And I feel cold. I feel distant. I need that warmth again. I need to know his fellowship. I need to know his love. We're going to bow our heads with no one looking around. And as we do, I'm going to ask, is there someone that would like me to remember you in my personal prayers, either this morning or throughout this day or tonight? And you would say, Pastor, would you remember me in prayer? You may know me, I may know you, I may not. That doesn't matter. You'd say, Pastor Kenyon, remember me in prayer. As her hand would slip up somewhere, someone would say, I feel outside the house this morning. I see that hand. I thank you. How many more is God speaking to you this morning? I feel outside the warmth of his fold. I see that hand. I thank you. You may put it down. Is there someone else who would say, Pastor, I long for that. I see that hand. Thank you. Thank you. I long to feel the fellowship of God. I need Jesus completely in my heart this morning. Younger or older, you'd lift a hand. I personally will be remembering you in my personal prayers. Someone else? And even on the television today, you may be miles away. If you will call this church, Pastor Moore will be glad to talk with you, be glad to share with you. And as you do, it will be a help. You'll find the number going up on your screen of the number to call. But today, Jesus loves you. Is there someone else just before I come to my closing prayer? Let me just take that a step further. Is there someone you still pray, you still talk to God, but you say, I need an empowerment of God to minister, to help others to come to Jesus Christ. I need an empowerment of the Holy Spirit in a strengthened way to help me to know what to do, how to talk to my loved one, how to talk to my friend, how to help someone to find the help they need. You'd say, Pastor, would you remember me in prayer today? Just all over this congregation, how many would say, I need more help of the Holy Spirit. I need more help of God. Just raise your hands all over this place. You say, I need more help of God. And with God's help, I will let him flow through my life. Yes, I see the number of hands. And today, today, I'm ready to pray. Father, I thank you for the privilege of being here in Ferreton Christian Center today. And Lord, to be representing, standing in the place of Pastor Woodson Moore, who is not able to be with us today. But Pastor Shirley Moore has been here in this hour. Lord, I would ask that as you would minister, first of all, I remember those who raised their hands that I promised to pray for, that they would come into a fellowship afresh and anew with you. I would pray that today there would be a change in their life as the Lord, they open themselves to you and they would say, Lord, my house, my heart, my home is open to you. Anything that is standing in the way, anything that is hindering today, Lord, that I can have a part, I ask not only for forgiveness, but Lord, I pledge myself to open my arms to you and to let you have a part of my life within this time. All of my life I give to you. And Lord, not only the three in the congregation that raised their hands, but maybe those that were listening in with the television, Lord, minister to them now. May, Lord, as we say the word come, as they come to you, as we believe upon you, your word says you will in no wise cast out. And in your divineness, Lord, you would now bless these individuals. And for those who are saying today, yes, I need greater strength to witness to my mother and my father, my brother, my sister, my friend at work. I need a greater empowerment of your Holy Spirit. As Lord, I would talk to people that I don't even know. We heard the witness at the fairgrounds today and appreciated the willingness to go on further and what is going to take place in the vacation Bible school this week. Lord, let your name, your Holy Spirit, just anoint and just bless and just minister. We covet this now. We covet this in your wonderful name. Lord, bless this congregation. As they'll be going to their homes today, may you go with them. And may they go with you. As they go about their places of work, their areas of this week, may, Lord, they follow you. And as they go, may their lights so shine that people may see their good works and glorify their Father, which is in heaven. We ask of this now in the name of our wonderful, wonderful Lord. Amen. Would you stand to your feet with me today? Would you turn to one near you this morning?